like looking at my, is Alex looking at my website making fun of it? I was looking for something wrong. I was looking for something wrong because I wanted there to be something wrong, because then she wouldn't have been so perfect in my eyes. And
I know. Oh, Alex, I'm so excited to have you on the show tonight. Welcome back. It is the Truth Revival, Sunday nights at 7 p.m. Eastern. I'm so excited to have Alex Perry. Oh, my gosh. You are all the things. You're an author. You're a speaker. You have an amazing practice where you help people gain confidence and learn to communicate so eloquently. So, and I think that it is also very interesting that this was my week for Rise and Thrive.
Yes.
To be launched. Like, my story was launched in social media this week. So I was like, oh, how cute. Alex is the one that introduced me on stage, and she's going to be on the Truth Revival tonight. So it's perfect. Everything works out exactly the way it's supposed to.
That actually ended up that way. That's crazy. How did that happen?
Yeah. So for a little context for the audience, you've probably heard me reference it, but gosh, how long ago was that? Right before COVID hit, we finished up a 7-month program called Rise and Thrive. That was me and 5 other women with 7 amazing coaches, Alex being one of them. And Alex, you have an amazing gift of helping people pull out the most confident, most beautiful parts of themselves, right? Like, what story? Because I had this thing before Rise and Thrive that my story didn't matter. And the reason why I believe that was because I didn't want to ever outshadow anyone, or I never wanted to feel like, you know, to what we were talking about before now, the game of comparison, right? Yeah. You know, and I can remember, you know, going through this program with you, and you were like, no, your story matters. There's someone out there that is, that needs to hear what has happened to you and needs to hear what's going on. So dig deep, find the one. And I have to tell you before we jump in, so my daughters are in the audience. They're 19 and 16, and they're crying, and they're like, Mom, there are, like, we didn't know that you were almost adopted. Like, we didn't know any of these things that you're sharing here tonight. Like, why don't you tell this? And I'm like, oh man, humility is not necessarily always, you know, like a thing to operate from, right?
Right. Well, sometimes, you know, that's not humility. That's just hiding.
Good point.
Humility, that's just point blank. I'm not going to talk about it. Pick the reason. I don't want to be too big for my britches. I don't want other people to feel bad. I don't want people to know because I feel weird and bad about it. That's real.
Yeah,
that's real. And a big stinky lie, because people need to hear your story.
Yeah.
I think about your story and the impact that it has had in so many women's lives.
Yeah.
So many mamas' lives too, because the tie between your story and your mom, and I don't want to ruin it for people because they need to watch it. So it's all over social media.
Yeah. Yeah, it's exciting. And, you know, it was just as therapeutic for me as it was for them. So we are not here to talk about me tonight. We are here to talk about you and this crazy, amazing book that you wrote.
The
Minivan Mogul, A Crash Course in Confidence for Women. But what I found out is it works for men too.
It does work for dudes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for all my dudes watching, don't stop watching, because confidence is for you too.
Right. And, you know, it's funny with the guys, because the guys are either all in or all out on the minivan. I've learned this through the whole experience with the name. So I will either get 100, yeah, I drive a minivan, or, you said minivan and women, I'm out. And I'm like, no,
wait.
It's called marketing.
Right. What's funny is you gave me a new, because I had the minivan. I've had 2 of them, and I had the minivan persona. So like that stigma, you know, and you gave it a new story for me. So I appreciate you and your minivan and all of our journey and ride in the minivan through this book and in real life. So tell us a little bit about it. What prompted you to write this book? What happened in your life that you said, you know what, this story needs to be told? There's a thing around confidence.
Well, I think it wasn't like there was this grand big moment where I said, this is what I'm going to write about. Here's what really happened was that I started blogging very, very early on in my job, in my career. Mm-hmm. And it was my therapeutic way of dealing with, I'd launched this business. I had no idea what I was doing. I was coming out of a job where I very much felt imposter syndrome, where I was very much coached to be pretty perfect, polished, button up, don't show your weaknesses, don't show your flaws. And I would literally drive around in my minivan and try to hide it. And I would do the weird stuff. Like I would park it in funny places just so people wouldn't see it. I would like try to walk up to other people's cars if I was walking out with a client, because I had all this stuff in my head that I couldn't both be a very successful professional or a CEO and be a minivan driver. Like that wasn't going to happen. So the idea for a book actually came from my business coach, Jenny Robbins, who had said, you're a good writer, you should think about writing a book. It's kind of what speakers do. You're like, you start speaking and then you write a book. And so I was like, okay, I'll write a book. And I start off with this, just not very nice. Actually, I give it a hard time, but I was trying to write a leadership presence book, and leadership presence kind of being a play on executive presence. I mean, it was awkward and not at all my brand, and no one would have taken me seriously in this book with that book at all. And so as I started to look at the stories, as I started to pull together pieces, I knew, number one, that ultimately what I was telling people was to be confident in themselves. And then I started playing around with names and titles. Again, my business coach had whispered in my ear, she said, hey, Alex, what if the minivan is your key to success? And that just stuck with me because I was always calling her and just making fun. And just like when I didn't feel like I had to be on for a client, I would be doing my funny stuff, like with the minivan. I'm like, here I go. I'm going to like back into my garage door again. Right. holding my executive meeting in my minivan and I can't even work the Bluetooth. And so that was me. And she's like, that's Alex. This is who you are. That's what makes you so great and so funny and so relatable. So I started toying around with the name. I had Minivan Millionaire at one point. And I was like, well, I'm not a millionaire, so that doesn't work. And then it was mogul came from, I used to tease with my hairdresser all the time. We would talk about how we were going to be business moguls. And so one day the two kind of crashed together and I was like, Minivan Mogul. That's hilarious.
I love it. And it's so you. It is so you. So we've had this conversation a million times, but I wanted to share it with our Truth Revival, audience, that I thought I had confidence in the bag, confidence. I was a confident kid. I was confident, I would show up, but like you, super buttoned up, like I got this, and as I, yes. And as I was reading the book, it showed some insecurities, like bright, like loud, and the awareness of it, right? Hey, it's still showing up for you. You just don't realize that you're operating from a place of insecurity. And that's what I love about this book, is I'm obsessed with it. You said before, you're like, you're my favorite engaged reader. I'm like, I just didn't know what I didn't know. And I say, I read the book because I was so excited because it was Alex's book. And I was like, I have no idea what I'm gonna get from this. I always get something from it, but it actually has really impacted my life and allowed for me to dig into confidence. So thank you. Thank you for being courageous and sharing this with us.
Well, thank you. I'm the opposite of you. I have felt like an imposter my entire life. I'm like, I don't belong in the room. So a lot, they're going to figure out that I don't know what I'm doing. Right. So a lot mm-hmm. of what you read in that is me processing that, is me owning that, me saying, hey, I walk into a networking meeting and I try to be something that I'm not, and then I feel miserable about it. And then I order a salad when I'm really freaking hungry, and then I starve on the way home in my minivan and I'm ticked about it, because if I had just shown up as myself, mm-hmm. which I do now, to the extent possible, right? Because it's never perfect, right? There are still times I'm like, ooh, weird. Yeah. Showed up. Wait, what was wrong with her? Awkward. That was awkward. Right. And 99% of that lives in my head, but it's that process of this is what I went through. This is what it's been like for me. And I know the difference. I know now the rules I have to follow, the things I have to do. I know the gut check and I know the confidence is a choice. I know this, like nobody else's business. You can choose. You can choose.
Well, and mine wasn't real. Like it was like it was a facade. It was like, I will fake this until I make this and y'all ain't gonna know. But then authenticity comes into it and people do realize, because Rebecca asked me one time, I was nervous about being on someone else's podcast. And she said, well, so which Amber's going to show up? And I was like, what do you mean? She said, is the authentic Amber going to show up? Or is the Amber who is going to say all the things that you think people want to hear from you gonna show up? And I was like, oh, Rebecca.
Oh, you got me. You're right through the heart. Oh, okay. Exactly what you want to hear, but that doesn't work.
Nope. And it was raw. It was me. It was authentic. And then that is when people can relate. So it was the key. It was amazing, beautiful. But I want to talk about this book. Like there are some stories in here that I just roll out. to the middle of it, but it's because it was the one that was the most relevant. And it's totally happened to me. You're sitting in the van, you're in a parking spot, you're blocked in.
Oh,
you can't get out. Yes. I was like, this has happened to me.
Has it really? That makes me feel so much better because
I didn't think it had happened to anybody else. I thought I was, because I don't. The other part of it is my family and my friends watching, they'll be laughing right now because I'm not very good behind the wheel of a car either. I will either hit things or things hit me, and I'll be sitting in the car, sitting still, not moving, and they just hit me. And so there's, you know, dings and dents and all these things, and I'm an avoider. Like if I don't have to parallel park ever again in a day in my life, I'd be fine with that.
Totally fine.
And then you add being hangry on top of it. You were hangry?
I was hangry. I was so hungry. I really did eat stale Wendy's crackers because I was bound and determined like to survive this experience. I was hangry. I was already ticked because again, you know, driving downtown is such a sacrifice in the suburbs, right? It's ridiculous. Right. Now in the middle of COVID, I give anything to drive downtown. Like, please get me out.
Right. Please. So tell our viewers what happened.
So I had got stuck. I was in a metered parking spot, an angled spot. And I was so excited because I found this downtown on a street. I was so happy because that's hard to find. And so I'd parked there. I went and saw my client. I come back out and the street was fairly narrow. And during the time that I had left my vehicle and then returned to it, a gigantic food service truck had parked behind me. And I don't have the world's greatest depth perception. So I can't tell how close I am to something when I'm backing out or I'm doing stuff. So I intentionally avoid those situations at all costs, if at all possible. So there's this huge food service truck behind me. And I'm like, I need to go. I'm hungry. I'm tired. I'm just going to back out. It's going to be fine. And so I proceed to try to back out. And I'm like mere inches away. I can't get the van out. I repeat this process back and forth, basically just doing the same movement over and over and over again. And I can't get out. And I'm starting to get panicked, right? I'm sitting there, like have my phone. I'm like, what the heck am I going to do? And I had looked around and there was nobody in the car next to me. I had no idea where the driver of the food truck had gone. And to my right was a Corzon service truck. And I don't even know what Corzon does, honestly. So I just knew it was Corzon. It's a bright yellow truck. And there was a driver in it. And he had been there the whole time. So I had spotted him when I first got there. I back out in and out and in and out and in and out. And he's oblivious, I think. I don't know. I didn't ever ask him. But I know he's there. And I just can't get the van out. And I'm like, I'm going to be stuck here all freaking day, you know, and I'm getting dramatic at this point, right? I'm going to die in my van because I can't back out. And I really want a sandwich and all I ever steal Wendy's crackers. So I'm like, not on a steal Wendy's cracker, trying to get out of this parking spot. And finally I'm like, I'm going to have to ask for help. I'm going to have somebody help me get this van out. And so I pop out of my van and I go over to the Coors and service truck and I knock on the window. And the guy was like, yeah. And I was like, can you help me back my van out? I'm stuck. There's this big thing behind me. And he kind of gives me one of those looks like, yeah, I can help you. And of course, at this point, I'm thinking he's probably going to murder me. Right. So I always immediately, it's either a brain tumor or I'm going to get murdered. Right. I have a headache. It means I have a brain tumor. If it's a stranger, I'm going to be murdered. And it's broad daylight in the middle of downtown. Come on. We live in Indianapolis. It's just not that bad. So anyway, he gets out. He's like, well, do you want me to direct you? And I was like, no, you could direct me all day long. I can't do this. So I hand over my keys from the van to this guy, stand outside of my van while he in like two little flips gets the van completely backed out. Hands the keys back to me. We joke for a moment. He's like, my wife has the same problem. She just can't do it. And I'm like, dang it. And then not to stereotype, because there's plenty of women that can drive very, very big things, but I'm just not one of them. I'm not. And so I have a minivan, but I'm mostly safe in it, but only moderately so. And I can't get out of parking spots. So I was so grateful to this guy. I completely forgot to ask his name. So I went home and I wrote this funny little letter and posted it all over Facebook and tagged Corzin because I wanted to say thank you because to me, it was so nice. I remember just being so relieved. I was like, thank you for this man. Because if he had not been there, I would still be stuck. I'm convinced I would have been stuck there now. I would have had to quarantine in the van.
That's so funny. Right. And the moral of the story is, and in the book, you guys, when you read it, like you have to, it's so funny because you work it up, like in your brain, you're like, he's judging me. You know, like you're just working this up scenario and we get so like in our head and in ourselves about it. And what's funny is it was no big deal. And you were free and you could go. So I think, and this is relevant to me in my life right now, it's not that difficult to go ask for help.
No,
you know, if someone gives you a task, they didn't ask for you to be the one that you like completely do the thing. Go ask your resources, go get help, enroll people into your life to help you figure out how to get to where you're going. And it was just a really cute example of like, I got places to go. I'm not the one to make this happen. I'm going to go find somebody that's going to help me get out of this mess.
Yeah. Well, and can we pause there for a second? Because I do think this lesson, so it comes in the chapter of, or with the road rule of, it's okay to stop and ask for directions. We get it in our heads and we think we have to be able to handle everything. And right now, especially where we are with online school and kids and work and everything is just so unsettled. We have to ask. Yeah. And lean into each other and know that other people are very much willing and able and want to help. It feels good to help.
Yes.
I love it when you're looking for help because then I'm like, oh yeah, I could totally help you. Not backing up. Don't ask me to help you back up, but
no. That's not the area you'll be getting.
We all have our own gifts and talents back to but like know who to ask, but just ask. That's one of the things that it's taken me a long time in life to learn. To be comfortable with it.
I love it. I have so much. It's like, where do we begin in this book? I jumped to the middle, but that was because that was where I was. Okay. So
yep.
I love this one. You ready? I've wasted a lot of time chasing after what confidence looks like on someone else instead of figuring out what confidence looks and feels like on me.
Oh,
I told you that when I was reading this book, I was reading the part where you were taking your daughter shopping. And there's a really fine line between relatability and comparison. right? Like we're trying to find and be in relation with one another and find that area of where it overlaps and we can like have a common bond, but then bam, the next thing I know I'm in comparison to what this person looks like and what they drive and what they, oh, like big brain, like they're so smart and all the things. And I'm like, that makes me feel really gross and really small. And that is not, no.
Yes. Well, and, or just, you know, you try for a while to be like someone else, you know, it's almost bad boyfriend syndrome. You're like, oh, well, this guy, like he really likes Queen. So I'm going to listen to Queen all the time too, but you don't really like Queen. It's not really who you are. It's not what you jam to. And yeah, you try that stuff on and then it just feels weird and it's disingenuous. And then you don't even know what you like. I spent so much time trying to be like other people. It was really hard for me to figure out what I liked, what I liked to do. And then back to what you said about the icky comparison, that super fine line of, you know, I think you're really cool. I think you're really great. Maybe I should be like that. Well, but if I'm like that, but you're so much better than me. And oh my gosh, next thing you know, I told this to Amber earlier, but you know, I'm looking at your website and I'm making fun of you just to make myself feel better. And that's bad. That's bad. Okay. I was telling her a story about how I kind of got caught in that trap with a woman, no one in Indianapolis. I've never actually even met this woman. I don't know how we got connected on social media, but I ended up, you know, I was not in a good place and I'm stalking her website and I'm looking at it and I'm like, ooh. And then I'm like kind of picking at it to make myself feel better. And I'm like, this is gross and wrong. She's fine. She's not doing anything wrong. And you're like, you're just mad at yourself because that's what you want to be doing. So go do your own thing.
Yes. Where I'm going to throw this out to the audience. Where are you not showing up as your best self? Where does comparison get you instead of being in confidence? So we'll see what the comments come back as.
That'd be good.
It would, because it's just it's a really big thing. And I feel like the older that I get, I think it's because the awareness is there, right? You can gut check it faster, but it still creeps in, and it is a tough thing to shake. So what do you do? How do you keep yourself from going there? Or if you're there, how do you shift back into confidence?
So that goes back to another one of the road rules, which is keep your eyes on the road in front of you. One of the things that I have to do is put blinders on to what's going on around me, because if I spend too much time looking at what everyone else is doing, then I end up in a really bad spot. So I'm in a coaching, speaking, influencer-esque area, right? And one of the things that I've had to do is unfollow almost every influencer, speaker, whatever type of person, not because I don't love the person, but because I will instantaneously compare myself to them. And then if I'm not operating at whatever perceived level they are, like, I love you, Brené Brown. I'm never going to be Brené Brown. Mm-hmm. Dang it. And I don't want to be Brené Brown. And Brené Brown doesn't want me to be her either. Right. Mm-hmm. That's not helpful. So I have to make sure that I'm constantly looking at, am I doing what I want to do? Am I choosing the things that make me happy? Am I doing the things that make me feel confident? Like wearing Chuck tennis shoes makes me feel really, really confident. Mm-hmm. It makes me feel off balance. Mm-hmm. I wear them sometimes, but we know in our gut. You have you ever done that? Have you ever bought an outfit that you bought because somebody else had it on and you thought you would look great in it? And then you put it on and you're like,
not so cute on me.
Because you're like, well, maybe it's going to fit. Maybe I'll grow into it. No, you knew to begin with.
Yes.
And you didn't trust that. That
thank you, Nicole Blair Ware, for making me very clear on what is suitable for this body and not necessarily, you know, just because I like that, it may not look good here. Right.
Right. Right. But I think we're oftentimes so busy looking at what looks good, what sounds good, what other people are doing, that we imitate that oh man, I just wrote this quote down. I have to see if I can pull it up. But it was like, you know, imitation is suicide.
It is.
You're killing the most beautiful things about yourself, and you're killing your confidence. Because if you're running around being anything other than who you are, then you can't possibly be confident. You just can't.
No. And that's people. That's the thing. That's one of the themes of this show, even, is the truth, right? The truth revival. We're reviving people's truth inside of who they are. And the truth is, God made you in His image, in your own uniqueness, in your own individuality. You know, we have these gifts. And that was a part of my story for Rise and Thrive. Like, I have these gifts. And when you illuminate the gifts that don't look like anybody else's, you know, that is when I have the utmost confidence.
Yeah.
That is when I operate from my highest self, is when I'm sitting in those gifts and knowing that they're mine. They're not mine to keep. I was born to give them away, but they're mine, and no one else can show up in my light, in my gifts. You know, just like I can't show up in Alex's. Right? I can't show up in Rebecca's. I can't show up in anybody's. Now, that's not to say that your gifts can't inspire me or inspire mine, right? Because I think in the beauty of it all is they all work together and make this whole beautiful world that we live in, right?
Mm-hmm. I always say you know, it's funny because people worry so much when we talk about stories and things like that. People get so worried. They're like, well, what if my story's not good enough? Or what if my story, you know, what if I say something that somebody else has already said? And well, of course you're going to say something that somebody else has already said. When you look at my road rules, they're not some brand new thing. It's just me saying it the way I would say it, using the tone, using the stories, which you couldn't possibly replicate, and vice versa. So when Amber writes her book, you're going to have a lot of the same themes. You're going to have a lot of the same lessons learned, but you'll say it in just a slightly different way that will land on someone's ear in a completely, it'll land on my ear. I'll be like, she said that. And it'll be us like probably like two articles away from what I said, but I'm like, that's the most profound thing I've ever.
And I think it matters at the time in your life that you read it too, right? Like, you could say it, I'm going to read it here. And then it goes through levels of interpretation and experience. And then we get to a different point. And then you read it at a certain time in your life and you're like, I've never heard that before.
Well, you have. People always worry about that. Like, what if I'm repeating myself? I'm like, we need repetition. Like, all day long. That's why people memorize stuff and recite it over and over and over, right, and over again, because it takes a long time for that stuff to become part of who we are and how we operate.
Yes, God knows. I think there's a number, like he's trying to teach you a lesson and he knows the number of times that he's going to have it show up in front of you, and however many different people it's going to take for you to realize, like, and then all of a sudden the stars align and everything works and you get it. And it's like, yeah, I'm kind of stubborn like that. I hear you. The other part that I loved about your book, and this is so relatable, is that a lot of times we'll take on, somebody will downplay your gifting, or somebody will call you a name or say something. I have to tell you that I've never even heard this word before in my life until you. And then I went and did all the research on it, looked it up, and I was like, yep. But you took it as a negative versus what a positive. And so, it's an old boss, right?
Yep.
And she said, I don't have that. It's effusive. She called you effusive.
Yeah. This is how, when I do this story in a keynote. So this is one of my signature stories in a keynote. So this is like point blank how she did it. She was like, I was only 90 days into this job. I was like, or maybe 40 days. I don't know. It's like, I was barely in this job. And it was supposed to be my dream job. Let me give the audience some context, but it was supposed to be my dream job. And I had moved from the medical world into the corporate world. So I really felt that pressure to be pretty perfect polished. And I remember we had met with her favorite client. And all I did, I was told not to even talk to the client, which I didn't really. And then at the end, when we went to shake hands, I looked at the woman and I was like, it's so nice to meet you. Like I would, you can tell I'm a smiler. I'm a gesturer. I'm a like
enthusiastic.
I would have hugged her if I could have hugged her, but I wasn't allowed to. And my boss pulled me into my office after that and said, we need to talk. And so she, you know, just basically went, you're just so effusive. And I was like, I'm brand new. I'd taken this huge risk. And I'm a sensitive, like my heart, I'm like the Grinch in reverse. My heart is two sizes too big. You know, my heart is always out. Like it's just beating. I'm like, please be careful with it. It's sensitive. But she said that to me and I started to cry because I was brand new in this job and I didn't know what that word meant. And I knew it was bad in my mind. And I got a Kleenex, wiped my face off. And she looked at me and she said, you're really hard on yourself. And I said, yes, I am. And she said, good, we won't have to have this conversation again. And so for nearly 2 years, I tried to pack away everything that was effusive. So if you had met me, you know, 4 years ago, you wouldn't recognize this person. None of this would have shown up at all. I would have been like, let's talk about communication. And so anyway, it took me a long time and it took me some journaling. And finally, I don't know why, but barely after I'd opened Practically Speaking, I looked up what effusive meant. And it means expressing feelings of gratitude in an unrestrained and heartfelt manner, overflowing, boisterous, exuberant. And I thought, hot damn, that was when I started to claim effusive is when I started to become minivan mogul. Before I even knew that was going to exist. But I'm like, that is who I am. Like, this is like, you want me as me. I am big. I get the, you know, tone it down sort of stuff. And I'm like, no, because I want people to remember me as a person who expressed gratitude. I want people to see me unrestrained. I don't think we have enough of that in the world today.
And I'm sure you're thankful for her bringing this up. Right. And you're in gratitude of the situation happening. So you could even realize that that was one of your gifts.
Yep.
Like, thank you for putting a verb to who I am and what I do. Thank you very much.
I mean, it was a rough 2 years of me trying to be something else. And that, you know, I left that job and I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know I was going to open Practically Speaking, but what she gave me, I mean, again, I look at it, it's the classic. I tell this story in so many keynotes. It's the story that I will have women come up to afterwards and they'll be like, I got that too. I had one poor woman at a workshop. She was like, I just don't understand why she thought that was so bad. Why did she think that was so bad? And I'm like, I think it goes back to, she didn't like what she saw in me because it, for whatever reason, that didn't fit her stuff. But yeah, it was a gift. It's been a huge gift.
That is a great gift. I'm glad that you're effusive because I am too.
Yes. Right. Like we laugh, we talk, it's part of what makes me a way better speaker than I was then. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry to every audience that ever had to listen to me before I started to loosen up.
Yeah.
So sorry. Yeah.
People oftentimes tell me, enthusiasm doesn't sell, Amber.
Really? Would you like not to be excited about the product?
I'm like,
I'm boring.
But do it okay. You know, I'm not just enthusiastic. I'm enthusiastic about life. Like I am excited about meeting people and hearing people's stories and being the solution behind a situation where things aren't working out for them. And that's personally and professionally. So, you know, it was said to me for the first time, probably 5 years ago.
Wow.
And I've heard it recently and I'm like, thank you for that. Right. Like I hear what you're saying and it is just a part of who I am.
Right. And I think disingenuous enthusiasm, I think if you're faking it, of course that doesn't sell. Just like anything doesn't sell if you're faking it, but, and maybe part of it is too, is like when I'm enthusiastic, I don't have to sell because I just am genuinely excited.
Yes.
I'm genuinely excited. And I want you to be excited too.
Yes.
Oh, so fascinating. Enthusiasm.
I know. It's interpretation, right?
It is.
So there's another part of, I mean, you know me, I love all the things about this book, but I love it because you talk about, it's something that we learned in a leadership course that I did. And he says it in the order of be, do, have.
Yes.
And you said it in the order of doing, having, or being. So being something on social media, you know, just be what others are doing, be what others are having, and being inauthentically, right? You, like, no. And so we're always in this rat race to like, be the thing, do the things, have all the things. And it's like exhausting.
I think I use the example in there of I might be crossing stories here, but it's like when you open up social media and you see somebody is making homemade dog footprints, like ceramic footprints of their dog. And you're like, oh God, maybe I should be doing that too. And I look at Max and I'm like, buddy, you know, I should be memorializing your life with that. Like, I'm such a...
Oh
my God, doing that. And then it's like, well, wait a second. The way I say it, it's like, I have a graveyard of half fulfilled, half done projects. Mm-hmm. I need to be doing what I do well. And again, not worried about what everybody else is doing. Cause that does kill your confidence. You're going to try to be like someone else. You're going to try to do what someone else is doing. You're going to try to have what someone else has. And you simply can't do that and be confident. You can learn from other people. I watch other people and I especially watch folks. I'm infinitely intrigued with folks who show no sign of negativity in anything that they do.
Mm.
Is right. So there's a line between that and perfection and a line between that and what I just can consider to be like, I will like just, they just portray optimism all the time. And that's what I hope to do is portray optimism all the time.
Yes. There is a difference between there is that I see that, wow. You know, one of the places in life I am most of the time a very optimistic person, but I'm also a very confident mother. One of the things in life is like, I got this motherhood thing down. Raising 5 kids is not for the faint at heart. And there are also times when I'm not feeling it, right? Like where everything's falling apart. And I told you today, I did the floating thing that Erica Ballard suggested with my other friend, Rebecca. And in it, they were, the thing that came out for me in the meditation was I am about experiences and outcomes. Yeah. So this is a perfect example. I want to create the most beautiful experience for my daughter's 16th birthday, right? Like I'm just like, oh, all the things, everything's going to be perfect. It's going to be great until I'm running around too long in the car and all the cake pops melt.
Yeah.
And they're the ones on the top of the stick. Not the other way around. Like not, yeah. Mm-mm. I was running around. I had forgotten them. It was like 95 degrees that day. Someone, we're putting things up in the house and someone says, where are the cake pops, Mom? And I'm like, oh no, they're in the car. Bad, 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 bad. So I go out, they're melted all like just a gooey mess. I think
that's not a good outcome.
No. No, 20 out of 60 of them made it still on the sticks. Now, leave it to my daughter. I love how you reference your daughter and you talk about your daughter. You want to, like, you never know for sure if you're actually doing a good job. Like, you get little glimpses. You're like, oh. So she's upset. I'm crying because I've ruined the birthday party. Like, you know, it wasn't perfect. And I leave for a few minutes, go finish up some stuff, and I come back, and she has taken all of the cake pops and that have fallen off the sticks and put them so beautifully on this little platter. And she's like, Mom, it's fine. She was like, they still taste good. And that's what matters. That it matters that you went and did this for me. It matters that, you know, she's like, it's going to work out. And so I'm a recovering perfectionist. So the fact that this did not go the way, like I lost confidence in myself. I felt like a terrible mother. I'm like, and she's like, no, you're fine. But now my friends and family made super big fun of me forever. Like
they're going to knock you down a confidence peg or two, right?
Oh my gosh.
Dang.
Yeah.
But isn't that true when you set yourself up for, I mean, it's even that difference of you say expectations and, or is that right?
Experiences and outcomes.
And it makes me think of experiences and expectation. Mm-hmm. Right?
Like not far. I had an expectation around that outcome and it did not turn out the way that I had envisioned in my mind.
So here's like, if I can tie that to one of the themes in the book, which is the last road rule, which is, you know, no matter how rough the road gets, just keep going. So what that tells me about that experience is, right, that, so that could have led to a massive meltdown. That could have, I mean, it did lead to a massive meltdown. Sorry, your cake popped. It could have really derailed the day for you and for your daughter.
Yeah.
So what she did was she just kept going with it. She's like, I'm just going to keep going. And I, like, of all the road rules, of all the things to do, and of all the things right now, it's so important that we keep going.
Yes.
Keep doing the things, even when our outcome is a little melty and messy. And our sticks are gone.
Oh, it was so bad, but it was so good. So
bad.
No one complained when they were eating it.
Right. No one complained. Cake. It's still cake. How lucky are we to have cake?
Right.
A big deal. Right.
I know. So it's just one of those where I was like, yep, this is one of those mom moments where I was feeling confident. I was super excited. And then I couldn't even, so this is another thing that you can speak to, like, because I wasn't confident, I couldn't communicate. All I could do was cry. All I could do was like throw bolstering and mean comments, like projecting my anger and my frustration out on the rest of the family because I couldn't figure my stuff out. Right.
Right.
And all of a sudden I was just watching this spiral and I was like, ooh, nope, this volcano is not going to erupt this way today.
Yeah. When we are not confident in ourselves, when we are in the process of what was probably in your head, the immediate, I'm going to start talking trash to myself because I messed up. I'm a crappy mom. So basically, well, you went from like, I'm going to give my daughter the 16th, this is her 16th, right? Mm-hmm. The 16th birthday experience of her dreams to, I am now the worst mother ever because the cake pops melted, which that's a pretty far gap, right?
Oh, it sounds awful.
You're like, and I don't deserve to be a mom. I don't even deserve this daughter and I'm going to cry. And so that's where I go, that confidence and communication is the first, like how you talk to yourself. That's what I address with everyone before I touch anything in communication is, what are you saying to yourself? Because if you are talking crap to yourself, mm-hmm. then you are going to talk crap to other people. If you are talking insecurity to yourself, then you're going to sound insecure. Our brains are basically just big gray blobs of stuff that, like, all they do, like, our brain gives a direction. Like, we give our brain a direction, it's going to follow it. Mm-hmm. So I tell this to people all the time when they speak. If you tell yourself how nervous you are, guess what you're going to do? You're going to create nervousness.
Oh.
And interestingly enough, excitement and nervousness feel the exact same. Sweaty hands, racing heart, shaking. Excitement. Nerves, how you label it makes a difference. So how you're talking to yourself, what you're saying to yourself, what you are saying to yourself is, I'm the world's worst mother. So your body's like, I'm a horrible mom. I'm going to cry and I'm going to not be able to breathe. I'm gonna yell at everybody because I feel like crap. So everyone else should feel like crap. And right. I'm going to spew all that negativity that I can't even contain within myself at other people. And that's not confidence. That's bad.
No. And I love that because you get to choose a more empowering way of viewing it, like being nervous. I remember when we were doing my Rise and Thrive speech and I was so nervous during like our practice session, like I could not get my stuff together. And then when it comes to showtime, which is weird for me because I've spoken in front of larger crowds than that. So it was like, what is going on that this is... But we had also built it up. Like we had also like put so much into it. I'm like, don't screw this up, Amber.
Well, and there's something to telling your personal story, which is way, way, way more vulnerable. So you might be able to get up in front of 2,000 people and talk tech.
Right.
And you've got to tell people how you were born, and you've got to reveal things about yourself on a personal level. Like the stuff that goes up there is big.
Yeah. But when you go to get on stage and you experience the excitement, everybody's rooting for you. We had you in the front row as the front row fan. You know, your friends and family are there. The excitement totally transitions into, and then you just do it. Then you just let it go and you just go and the words come out and whatever was supposed to be said was said.
Yep.
And nobody else was none the wiser, right? All this practicing and all this stuff, like, and you know your story, you know, deep down in your heart, you know your story.
Yeah.
That's what I love about your work. That's what I love about who you are and what you do is you help people actually operate from a place of their authentic self.
I try. And, you know, you want to take it back to confidence, that sort of, I'm thinking about you as the mom that went from zero to best mom to worst mom in like
1 second.
What I find is that we immediately go to that, what I call catastrophic language. I am the worst. This is a disaster. This is going to ruin me. And none of those things are true. Mm-mm. Well, true is you made a mistake, right? Or it was an accident even. I you forgot. That's right. Not nearly as scary as life is ruined. If you want to feel confident, start paying attention to how often are you using catastrophic language to describe situations that are not catastrophic at all.
I love that. That's so true. How we label ourselves. Mm. So the last one, and there's so much more, but in order to find out, they're going to have to go get your book and they're going to have to read it all. So I'll give one little fun last thing away. It kind of goes back to what we were talking about in the beginning. There's nothing unique about me. But it says, if you're like me, you worry that the answer you give won't measure up to what others want to hear. Or you worry that if you go with your first thought, you might not sound as interesting or as intelligent as you like to. Maybe you worry that your answer will leave you looking like you're bragging or arrogant, back to what I was saying. So then in response to those worries, you come up with an answer that is awkward, at least by your standards. Yes. And the thing I love about you too is you make awkward totally okay. There are daily awkward moments. And I'm like thinking of so many times when I've like walked through this before and I'm like, oh yeah, the outcome of that was totally awkward and nobody died. We laughed about it. It was super funny and we're moving on, right? Maybe they'll remember me because that was so awkward.
Yes. I was ridiculous. I am on a mission of some sort to normalize awkward, because how else, if you're so worried about a mistake, we make people paranoid of mistakes or awkward moments or like the weird high five moments that happen. Back when we used to be able to hug each other or do handshakes, there was always that weird moment of, are you going to hug or handshake? And we make that so hard. And I don't think it has to be that hard. I think you just
No. Yeah. We say dumb things. Like we just say things in meetings or we say things. I had that experience this past week where I was not getting anything right. Like nothing that came out of my mouth was like, nope, that was not it. And then you roll with the punches, right? Like you just keep going. You're like, okay, maybe nobody caught that. I don't know. I caught it. And it could have been exactly what it was supposed to be in that meeting. Who knows?
Or you could just own it.
Yeah.
You know, so one of the things that I do when I present, and it's become a thing, it's really fun, is I tell people all the time that I speak typo. I say things wrong. I spell things wrong. I have to go back and correct myself. And it's the truth. Because as a speaker, especially as somebody who coaches speakers, if I can't own up to the fact that I don't get this stuff right all the time, that I got to make it safe, or because not everyone, I'm very sensitive to how hard it is for some folks to speak up because they have experienced so much pain or shame or ridicule or just the fear of it is it paralyzes folks. And I don't want people to be paralyzed. I say all the time, what would you say today if you knew tomorrow you would never speak again? Because I take that really seriously. So while I again, two things are true. I speak typo. And there's the very real possibility that tomorrow I may not get a chance to say something. So I better be able to say it now. So that's how I look at all of this. And I look at minivan mogul and confidence and like, here are the rules. Make the choice. I'm going to be confident in doing it. Even if that means I'm going to say it wrong, it's going to come out weird. It's going to be awkward. And I'm going to have to do it again. At least I'm going to choose the path that says I'm going to try.
That's right.
So.
That's right. And that was a great lead into what I was going to ask next. So Alex, what do you do? How do you help people and how can they reach you?
Ah, great. Great question. So I am a public speaking / communication coach. You can find me all over social media at PS with Alex. I do individual coaching. I do group coaching and I do keynotes. So that is the bulk of my business. That's how I work with folks. Everyone from the quiet person in the office that's like the person around the table that doesn't say anything to the CEO that's looking to sound fabulous on their keynote. How else can you find me? You can find me on LinkedIn at Alex Perry. And you can find Minivan Mogul on Amazon,
Barnes & Noble. And at Target and at Barnes & Noble.
Target, which is super fun. And that's
how it's so exciting. So for businesses, tell me about that. Do you work with business like groups of people and helping them to communicate, you know, build culture, those types of things?
Yeah. Most of the time when I say communication, I am dealing with interpersonal communication and like, how do I operate as a communicator? How does the team operate from a communication standpoint? So that's my focus. I don't really do culture or anything like that. I'm the nitty gritty practical person. So the thing that I'm known for is making things really simple, making communication really easy and a whole lot less scary. So for example, I'll go in and work with a group of human resources folks tomorrow, and I'm going to teach them a really simple 3-part framework for how to speak for themselves at meetings because it's hard. Right. Mm-hmm. So what do you do if you've already had that seat at the table, but you don't know how to use it? I'm particularly interested in working with women as well, because when you look at the tie between communication and confidence, if you're not confident, you're not communicating well. And if you're not communicating well, you don't look or sound confident.
You're not getting your stuff done. You're not completing the visions that you have for your life, work, at home, wherever, if you're not communicating with confidence. It impacts everything.
I have a quote that I use a lot now, which is, we worry so much about finding our voice. I'm like, worry less about finding your voice. Worry about using the voice you already have.
Yes. Yes. And you're also doing a workshop.
I am. About that. So I am doing an all women's communicate with confidence virtual training series. So this starts in September. It is a 6-week training series. We are meeting twice a week. We're diving deep. So going through everything from imposter syndrome and how that's impacting your communication. We're going to talk about boundary setting, negotiation, asking for what you want, using your seat at the table, planning and dreaming for being the type of communicator that you've always wanted to be, but never gave yourself the permission to do. And what's so cool about this is it's a small group of women. So you get that bonding, you get that place as an executive to share your worries. You're outside of your own company. You get a great network of folks. So this is going to be a great series. I'm really looking forward to doing this.
Oh, I love that. So if you're interested in any of those things, please comment in the comments and I will make sure that you get connected. You can reach out to Alex directly on social media. I will make sure that you get connected because that is another one of my gifts because I like to connect people.
Yes,
make sure they know all the people. I am excited for what you're doing, Alex. I love that you sat into your gift and you are honing in on it. You're using it and you are making the world a better place and really helping people dig into who they are and using their gifts.
Well, you are a gift, Amber. You are. Thank you.
Yes, I am. Yes. And thank you so much for writing this amazing book and being on here tonight and sharing this with me. You're amazing and super fun at doing it. So I can't wait to go finish and read the last part of it and see what else is in store for me.
Oh my gosh. Let me know what you think of the conclusion.
I will. And it's going to be on podcast. I'm sorry. You started a podcast and it's going to be on Audible, right?
Yes, it will be on Audible. It just wrapped up all of the edits. And so it's going into production now. It'll probably be about 2 months. So it'll be a little bit, but until then you can tune in. I totally forgot my own podcast, the Minivan podcast, where I have invited 6 confidence road warriors into my virtual minivan. I wanted to give folks a little present because, you know, we're still in the middle of COVID. We're still in the middle of this pandemic. And so I invited some really inspiring people to come and share with me their tough times, how they got through it, how they find confidence every day to tackle this tough stuff. It's so good. It launches on Wednesday.
I cannot wait to listen. I cannot wait. You are fantastic. Thank you. Thank you so much for being on here. Thank you to all of our viewers for being here, all of our listeners. We appreciate you. I do want to give you a little bit of info. We are actually moving the Truth Revival from Sundays to Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. to accommodate my co-host who hasn't been able to be with us in the last couple Sundays because he's been traveling and Sundays is his travel day. So
awesome.
I know. So Wednesdays starting after Labor Day at 7 p.m. Eastern time on Wednesday night. So the next time you're on, Alex, it'll be on a Wednesday like it was the first time.
I would love to meet your co-host.
Yes, you get to meet my co-host. You'll love him. He's freaking fantastic. And we're just going to continue to have a lot of fun doing transformational work and loving on people in the world. So
awesome.
Yep. Everybody have a great week. Alex, we'll talk to you so soon.
See ya.
See ya.